with you. Hard act to follow. A very hard act to follow. It's just looking on first. Well, we'll start with something easy. As Jeffy mentioned, in 2009, you took over as CEO of Xerox. So it's been 3.5 years now. You are in the middle of a pretty monumental transformation of the company, which is shifting it from product technology, copiers, printers, to services. And that's been going on for quite some time now. Pretty much has defined so far your tenure. How's it going?
I'd say it's pretty good. It's still a lot of work to do on a go-forward basis. We know what the value proposition of the company is, how we can best place clients. We know what we do very well. We also know what we don't do well. And a lot of the work that lies ahead of me in the short term is to fix the things that we don't do well and to magnify and accentuate the things that we do well. What we do well is we help, unlike these really sexy companies that have, like Google or Apple, that have all the, this great data that you can see and touch and feel, we actually work in the back office of large companies. And, so most clients don't really know we are there. But we allow companies like Apple or Google or IBM or P&G or American Express, you name it, the companies or governments in the United States or around the world, to actually operate in front of their clients very well. That transformation is like earth shattering for our company. Jimmy said that he took over a company that's very well foundation and had a good strategy, and kind of the role was to kind of keep it going. Not stay still, but keep the momentum going. I took over a company that was solid, but was becoming significantly more every day less important in the minds of people. What we did was cool, it was key, but people actually didn't think it was valuable for their business. And in actuality, every day it was probably becoming less and less valuable. So what we had to do was figure out a way to continue the company's history of being a great client-facing company, a great innovative company, a reputable company, a global company, and to figure out a way to keep these very strong things, but make what we do more sustainable in the future. This whole idea about transforming every single day is really important, not settling in, not falling in love too much with what you did well in the past. Do that well, but also be really ready to change. And the good news is that we were aware of this, but we didn't and we started it. I took over as because we didn't sit still and say, okay, we're pretty good at printing copiers, multi-function devices, black and white color. We do that really well. We'll just keep doing that forever. It was clear to Anne, it's clear to me for sure that if we continued to do that only, that 20, 30 years from now, we would not exist as a company. And my goal is to make sure we exist 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 100 years from now. So that's the change that we have to go through.
What about your own evolution as a CEO now that it's been 3.5 years? Obviously, you were no stranger to Xerox. You've been there for 30-some years. You were president before. What about being CEO has been different? What did no one tell you, not even Anne Mulcahy? What did you have to learn for yourself?
Well, I had a great, had probably one of the best transitions out in the career. And most people know her and know she's like, cool and really engaging and, no bull crap.
It's okay. We're not friends. It's okay.
Public in person. So I had the benefit of being watched in a kind of a hands-on but faraway way. So I was not inspected every day, but I was guided a lot. If you look at Anne and you look at me, we are so different people. I mean, it's just amazing. Her background, my background, is 180 degrees apart. But we have a commonality that made my transition easy, and that was that we had spent our lives at this company. We loved it. We loved the people in it, and we were invested well beyond money or history. We were invested kind of in our hearts and our souls. So the transition between Anne and I was easy from that perspective. She warned me that the first thing she said to me is that you can't be Anne Mulcahy. You cannot lead from Anne Mulcahy's feet. You have to lead from Ursula Burns' feet. but, you know, talking back to, we're very different people.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, Jane is loved. She's been at the company forever. She's a sales, like, goddess and everything. And I'm an engineer who's been at the company forever, but was really inside the company. And I had to figure out how to position myself and not deposition him, you know what I mean? Because the benefit that she brings to the company, she brought to the company, you cannot take away. That's something to build on, not something to diminish. So it was really hard for me to kind of settle in to being the leader of the company from my perspective, not from Anne's perspective, not to continue to look back and say, I wonder what they're thinking. I wonder if they're wondering whether I'm crazy or not, those kinds of things. But it happened really quickly. After about 2 or 3 months, you figure out kind of where you're supposed to be and what you're supposed to be doing. And you also realize that, at least I did, that saying the word I used to have this really big difficulty saying, I want you to do this. You know, or I want it done by then, or it's going to be done because I want it done. But, you know, I had this really big difficulty saying the word that I wanted something done, and I got really used to that. When I got used to that, it got easier.
Everything was getting easier. Well, speaking about no BS, I mean, one of the sort of trademark things about Ursula is that you are blunt, you are frank, you speak directly, you speak the truth. Anne has said one of the things she values about you was that you have the courage to speak the truth even in ugly times. Is that still a big part of your identity? And is that
that's
also helped you elevate throughout your
people. The answer is, yeah, that's kind of my identity, but it's not one of these things where I wake up in the morning and say, oh, today I should speak the truth, I should speak the truth. I was raised in an environment where the way that I speak is the way that people spoke. So I couldn't learn any other way. I tried, by the way. I got speech classes, you know, all of the stuff that you do. And I realized that I was more convincing to both myself and people who were listening when I actually said what I thought versus what I thought people were going to say. Sometimes this gets you in a lot of trouble. I mean, very, very often, and sometimes it's just not appropriate. It sounds great, everybody's laughing, but sometimes it really clears the bigger hole for you to dig out of than you can imagine.
Is there an example of that?
Often, yeah, many. I mean, most of them happen in interactions with the government with me, right? And what you have to learn is that people can hear things when they're ready to listen, not only when you're ready to say them. And I have to be better at reading when people are ready to listen. Because if you say something when somebody's not ready to listen, it just kind of, it's noise. And you don't want it to be noise. So, this idea of being blunt and speaking frankly is not something that I think about doing. It happens to be the way that I was raised or the kind of the environment that I was raised in. Women are different than men.
Hint,
hint, agree? Yeah. You know, it's interesting that this is why we're no different. We are very, very, very different. By the way, I think over time, if we continue the way we're going to start pretty soon, maybe 15 evolutions from now, 15 generations from now, we may not be. I think one of the big benefits that we have today is that we're different. And one of the things that, in my family, my mother was extremely strong. I've heard Vinny say that her mother led by example. My mother led by example as well, but she also led very clearly with words. My mother was a speaker, and she would paved the path that she wanted us to walk down by telling us that path. And then she would tell us when we were doing it well and when we were not doing it well. So I learned from her that, you say things. You're doing well today, I'm doing well, I feel good, I don't feel good. This is really messed up. Why are we doing it this way? Why are we so slow? You know, all these things that are really dangerous questions to ask often are things that, because of the way I was raised, my mother used her mouth to actually guide us. And so that's how I lead as well. I use obviously use actions, but I use my mouth. I don't let people go away too confused with what I'm thinking.
We were talking in the green room about your daughter a little bit, and you had said last time you were on stage at a Fortune event with Patty at our dinner in New York a year and a half ago, you were nervous, you were stressed out because your daughter was in the front row. You were completely nervous, which I thought was fascinating. But it just brings to mind, talk a little bit about your daughter, given how important your mother was to you, and all you've learned, and all you've done to rise in your career, what can you tell your daughter?
My daughter is 19 years old. I have a 23-year-old son who's 99% perfect. I'll send it to you, probably something I haven't discovered, the 1% that is not perfect. Amazing boy. He is a beautiful boy, a graduate of MIT, undergraduate graduate school, works for Morgan Stanley now. He's it's great. And he's easy. He's like a little, you know, it's not a little dog. Like a puppy dog. So he's, you know, he just loves me. Loves his father. He's pretty cool. I have a 19-year-old daughter who's like a cat. And he's a big challenge because she learned what my mother taught me. I guess I taught them, which is she speaks her mind. And my son is a little bit more. Just as long as I'm happy and everything, you know, he's happy, everything's cool. My daughter, even if we're happy, pushes everything. So if I make a speech, and I very rarely make it in front of my kids, and this day I was, and it was one of these, you know, godforsaken things. Patty was going to interview me. My daughter was in the audience, and she was alive, you know, 17 or 18 years old at the time, but she could actually judge what I was saying. I was really nervous. Because he would actually call me on just about everything after I got to stage. But it turned out to be really good because what my daughter sees of me and what my son sees of me is this, like, two people. They see a person that they read about a lot. They read it and he, you know, is listed in things. And then when I get home, there is no connection, there's no overlap. There's very little overlap between that person and the person who walks in the door. Primarily because my family has pushed really hard to make it clear to me that there's no overlap between those people. So, my daughter is one of the key people here. So she's really interesting. She's a great, I'm so amazed at both these kids because at 19 and 23, they were where I was at, like, 30. The way that they think, the way that they articulate things, how much impact they think they can have, how strong opinions they have, how well-read they are on politics, on energy, we just had a big debate on energy and energy companies. And you think things get over stuff. You know, that just throw out a comment. And the kid will say, hey, I got it. Yes, I agree with that, Mom. Almost, even if she agrees with her, it would be, talk about how you said that and that kind of thing. But she turned out to be my mother. So, you know, comes full circle.
And she's at NYU.
Yeah, she's a junior at the Gallatin School at NYU. And she's studying social anthropology, linguistics, and math. And she intends to do something on urbanization and this whole idea about how you get 9 billion people to live in a socially acceptable way in urban centers, because that's where we're all moving towards. And if we just did what we did today, I mean, this place is going to be a disaster. This world is going to be a disaster. It's going to be very bifurcated between haves and have-nots. And so there's this whole move on to figure out how do you make the world livable. How do you use language to do that? How do you use computations to do that? And her analytical thinking, and how do you use the knowledge that people actually like, how people like to live, to actually change that? It's pretty cool.
One of the things we're doing this year is we're asking a handful of speakers to give some really specific advice on a few things. So I'd like to, we're almost out of time here, but I'd like to ask you for 3 pieces of advice that you would give to someone who is succeeding an iconic leader or CEO, 3 kind of tangible things to establish. Now, one is, I loved Jane's comments about how to develop a strategy. She said it better than I could have ever said it, but this is the path that we're on as well. Each
strategy statements that you write down. That's when you try to memorize them, you can never remember the words, you get all screwed up. I mean, there's this kind of, you know, and then when you do memorize them, it sounds like everybody memorized them. So this idea about having a set of beliefs for your company and on behalf of your customers and on behalf of the environment that you work in is one of the things that I think that every CEO who succeeds, a good CEO, has to continue to reexamine. Because if what you do is settle in, right? You settle in and say, well, all I have to do is what she did, in my case, what she did, what you'll find out is that you're going to be run over by change. Just, you know, change just because people are not happy with staying the same, even though things are good, or change because things must change. And so this idea of setting out a path that is very aspirational and being, second point, impatient towards achieving it. One of the things that I instituted in my company is Xerox is this idea of impatience and aversion. And I got this from whenever I travel around the world, including in New York City and in the United States, whenever I go to Washington and all the government places, the heads of states that I go to, there's always a conversation about what's wrong in a way that, and education is one of my big passions, science, technology, engineering, and math education, and we are really screwing it up. Every time I'm up here, you say it. We're getting a little bit better every day, but I mean, we got such a long way to go. And when you talk to people about fixing it, it's spoken in a language that we have time. Like, we'll do this, and then we'll do that, and then we'll do this. And when that all happens, you probably have 4 or 5 generations of kids who have gone through the best system. So my theory of the case is that we should actually not talk about it unless we have time. We should not talk that we have time. We should be unbelievably impatient on fixing it. In our company, it's around risk-taking, this idea that it's better to not take a risk than to take a risk. It's better to, I have it flying in front of my wall that says, sooner rather than perfect. Mm-hmm. And just the idea that you should plan for perfection, mm-hmm. and we'll take the time to do that and then we'll act, is one of the worst, so this idea of impatience, so that's the second, mm-hmm. second thing. And the third thing that I will tell you that nothing trumps is hard work. I am another one, and I think, I'm always out of Manhattan, and I become a CEO, and I'm like, this is pretty cool. So I can actually work a little bit harder. Because people do stuff for you. Mm-hmm. And you figure, people are doing all the stuff for you, you can probably do a little less stuff. Mm-hmm. Absolutely not. Well, for every moment that you have for you, there's something that can fill that moment. And I'm a believer that you should actually try to get as much things to fill the moments that you have for you, that are useful, and actually work hard towards achieving them. And if you succeed somebody who did well, I think the best success can possible. Like, so people say, let's just go right down. I actually don't believe that at all. I think that you have everything set for you. A lot of work to do. You have a lot of things set. You don't have to worry about, are you structured correctly? Is the capital, do you have enough capital in your business? Are people good? We had all that set. All you have to do is make some tweaks to head in the right direction.
Strategize, be impatient,
and work hard.
I wish we had more time. Thank you, Ursula. It's been great.